lecture I want to talk about is the international responses to the Hungarian 1956 revolution, which seems to be much larger and much more significant than the thought before. I also want to add that this is a kind of research that seems to be that it's over, it happened 60 years ago. But the importance or even the delicacy of the whole undertaking is expressed maybe by the pure fact that many of the very important historical documentations remained closed for decades, and not only by the Hungarian authorities or by the other Central Eastern European countries which were responsible directly or indirectly for all what happened during and after the events, but also at the United Nations, which was one of the most important institutions and remained to be so, and for both the revolutionaries, the Hungarian youngsters and workers and intellectuals who stood up for freedom and independence during the dramatic days, and later for everyone who was looking for a kind of political solution, the United Nations, the UN, was a source of hope, or at least a tool, a mean to have the consolidation of a situation that was more than dramatic, not only for Hungary, but for the whole international context. Let's first have an international context for the 1956 revolution, which was very important for us, and I think it remained so a point of reference for all the Central and Eastern European democracies for quite a long time. 1956 was important because that was the 20th Congress of the Soviet Communist Party, which was a kind of start of the détente, a kind of facing the crime of Stalinism. It was slowly possible to talk about what happened during the most horrible years of the communist rule. The other important aspect that certainly helped the Hungarian revolutionaries, or that time reformists, to think about a future that may not be that horrible as the past was also that a type of fermentation started all over in Europe, and particularly in the Soviet bloc. The Polish example was very important, that there may be a chance to create a socialist rule with a human face. The other important topic, that there was a group, a young intellectuals group led by a communist leader of the time, Imre Nagy, who was the prime minister for a short period. His name was connected to a certain liberalization of the Hungarian Stalinist rule, and then he was pushed away, and a restoration of the Stalinist rule avoided to execute his program, which was very important by the 56 revolution, its spontaneity. It was not planned. There was not a secret group of Bolsheviks like it happened 100 years ago, who already had a mastermind how we shall take power. It started as a demonstration, and it started to accelerate, and it was a wonderful dynamics of the revolution. It would be very important to analyze in depth how one event led to the other and how many coincidences paved the way of the historical necessities. The other important part was the very sudden victory of the revolution, how easy it was to take power and to get rid of this old Stalinist. The beginning of the revolution, it seemed to be that the victory is not hopeless, not only in Budapest, but also in Moscow. For a certain days, as we can know it from the so-called Malin notes, who was a person at the Politburo, at the highest ranking party commission in the Soviet Union that time, making notes. At the beginning of the revolution, Mikoyan and Suslov, two politicians, came to Budapest and went back to Moscow to report that it's not that bad. Let's try to negotiate. Let's try to organize somehow a compromise with them. And it seemed, even at the end of October 56, seemed that it may be possible to create a new socialist, new relations between socialist brotherly countries, as they like to go that time, and the even all the demands or the requests of the revolution may be answered favorably by Moscow. And from one day to another, it turned back to the total opposite, probably for two reasons. One was that maybe a provocation or a bloodshed happened in Budapest at the Köztársaság tér, when the communists started to be threatened. What if a new terror, a new revenge, a lynching would start and all the communists will be killed? Very soon, the lynching photos of the Köztársaság Republic there arrived to Moscow, to frighten the Politburo. And the other very important segment was the Suez Crisis, that at the very same time when the Hungarian Revolution happened in Suez, in Egypt, Israel, with the help of Britain and France, attacked Egypt, and very soon the Soviets could be afraid of a new world war or a new war when they cannot be on the loser side, so they cannot let Hungary go. Pravda, the party organ, published a statement of the Politburo saying that there will be a new chapter in the history of the socialist countries, and at the very same time when it appeared in the morning, military preparations started to happen to crush the Hungarian Revolution with military force. What did the United Nations and what did the international community do in that time? How do they respond to this event? Only in 1955, the magic moment arrived that Hungary could join to the community of nations. And it's again a very controversial process. Not only that it was an international kind of bargain, that you can adopt certain countries from the Western sphere of interest and we shall also let some socialist countries get in. The other part was, in a sense, more difficult, that the whole idea of the for applying the membership was executed by the Stalinist leaders of Hungary, or the neo-Stalinist leaders, in 54, 55, 56. And the concrete steps, how to organize everything inside the United Nations, was arranged, as archival evidence suggests, by the communist secret police, in Hungarian AVH, or AVH. They wanted to have a good position in New York. There are very interesting books and documents about how the UN was infiltrated by secret agents. Shevchenko was a Soviet undersecretary general who published a whole book about that, but Oleg Kalugin, who was the resident of the KGB in New York at the very same time, also published a book titled The First Directorate. When the revolution broke out and the first Soviet invasion started somehow to stop that, the United Nations immediately put the Hungarian issue on the agenda. And then the Hungarian representative at the UN, Peter Kós, immediately stood up and said it's an internal affair of the country, so the UN has nothing to do with that. A huge uproar followed his protest. And even Kós was recalled immediately from New York. They identified him also as a Soviet citizen, and his real name was Konduktorov, which was true. But that was also true that he exactly forwarded the message of the Imre Nagy foreign ministry, who wanted to stop the United Nations because the Soviet Union, the Moscow said that that's the condition to negotiate peacefully a solution with Hungary. The number two person was representing Hungary, János Szabó, who was actually a secret agent directed by the KGB, so he knew much before about what's happening in Moscow and how the Hungarian Revolution will be crushed than the members of the Hungarian government who later became nominated. So he had excellent first-hand information from Moscow at that time, and he was the one, then finally Imre Nagy sent a cable to New York at 1st of November and 2nd of November saying that please, the UN should include the Hungarian issue on the agenda and try to call up the Hungarian Soviet authorities to negotiate, then János Szabó, the agent, just did not forward this message of Imre Nagy. He said later that Imre Nagy should send a fascist to New York to forward this message to the United Nations. Imre Nagy then sent a second cable that arrived to the UN, but again it was very interesting that the Secretary General and the whole Secretariat of the United Nations was not that swift to respond to the Hungarian request. And it's also very interesting, as archival evidence proved, that all the information that arrived to the table of Dag Hammarskjöld, the Swedish diplomat who that time was the Secretary General of the United Nations, was very sympathetic to the Soviet point of view. So meanwhile, the headlines of all the international newspapers were packed with what's happening in Hungary. The reports that actually the Secretary General received said that, oh, it's very chaotic, the Prime Minister doesn't really know what to do, there are controversies that it's not possible to work out a serious solution. So I would say that all the time he was misguided by his very deputy, Dragoslav Protić, who was a Yugoslav diplomat, and the role Yugoslavia played throughout the revolution and later was also very controversial, as I'm happy to comment on that later. Anyhow, the United Nations at the same time had first a cable that it's an internal affair, had second and third cable that please help something, but their hands were full with the crisis in Suez. A real war started to break out in Suez. Bombing and parachutists arrived there, and so as there was the channel, there is oil, there is the whole Middle East. And the interesting thing was that at the Suez crisis, on one side, there were Britain, France, and Israel, and on the other side, there was the United States of America and the Soviet Union. The new colonial powers against the old colonial powers. And they could create a coalition, a wonderful... And that's how they could immediately find a solution in Suez. They made out of nothing a huge army, and the army in 2 days were totally dressed up, weapons, everything, and then they were flown to the Suez Channel. They stopped the bloodshed there, and that already created a total hopeless situation for Hungary, which was behind the Iron Curtain. There was no real chance that anyone would be able to interfere militarily into the Hungarian matters. And when the Soviet invasion came at the morning of 4th of November 1956, it was totally clear that the United Nations is not in a position to help at all, only rhetorically. But that rhetorical help costed a lot of lives. People, and particularly when the Radio Free Europe started to say that, please, keep up, we shall help you, which was totally untrue. Even they gave concrete instructions how you can fight against the Soviet tanks. And I mean, actually the kids, the so-called kids of Pest were very successful to blew up one tank after the other with Molotov cocktails. But it costed a lot of life, and the UN meanwhile said that we shall have to work out a solution, we shall try to help. Actually, it immediately understood that there is no way to help, particularly as they did not want to risk the very fragile coalition that could somehow find a solution to the Suez Channel. Meanwhile, Budapest is far, it's a small country. We cannot really negotiate how to deal with this situation, except that we shall express our opinion that it's not nice what's happening there. What happened actually that Hungarian revolutionaries for quite a long time was waiting for the United Nations to help. Even there we found leaflets and radio broadcasts saying that please wait, the UN is already on the way to help you, which turned out to be totally false and a total lie. Anyhow, what happened that the United Nations and Dag Hammarskjöld personally, who was a very talented diplomat but was a very pragmatic Swede, understood where he has a moving space and where he doesn't have a moving space, and the last was Hungary, but he understood that, okay, politically we may not be that successful, but the humanitarian assistance can work. And the country was in a horrible shape for several reasons. And again, all these files that I could find and consult in New York tell a lot about this immense effort of the United Nations, how to feed the Hungarians, myself as well. I was born in 56 and I got milk powder from the United Nations. And also how the UN can help to the 200,000 Hungarian refugees who left the country at the very same time, 180,000 to Austria and 20,000 to Yugoslavia, and it was the largest humanitarian refugee crisis after the Second World War in Europe. In a very interesting phenomena that it was not the UN who helped them, but the Red Cross. The UN remained, in a sense, in incognito, knowing that there is a political debate between the United Nations and the Hungarian government of Kádár, which was the illegitimate government because the prime minister, the legal prime minister, Imre Nagy, was in the Yugoslav embassy where he found shelter in the morning of 4th of November. The UN realized that if we want to help, we have to find a smokescreen, we have to find someone else, and that was the International Red Cross. So all the shipment that the International Red Cross carried to Hungary, distributed here, was actually not all, but a big part of this shipment was from the United Nations. Also, the refugees were taken care of the United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees. That was the way how the UN helped, and they sacrificed the political solution. It's a very difficult compromise to understand or to explain, but was again a pragmatic solution. Not let more Hungarians die, but let to happen what we cannot avoid or cannot turn back. The situation looked a bit like the UN is still dealing with the Hungarian issue. And it was also very interesting. Dag Hammarskjöld, the Secretary General, offered several times that he would travel to Hungary and try to negotiate both with the revolutionaries and both with the new power. He was rejected to come to Hungary. There were very wild ideas that Hammarskjöld should just flew in to Hungary with a white airplane with a UN symbol on the tail, and then they would not turn him back. Hungary has to let Hammarskjöld in. He didn't come. Or he has to use the Danube as an international water, and he would be able to come, but it was not allowed, and it did not happen. There are very interesting background notes. There was a wonderful Indian diplomat, Raman, who very closely observed all these happenings and all the situation, and India being, in a sense, neutral and independent, has a much larger moving space than either the Western democracies or, of course, the socialist countries. Raman said that Hammarskjöld did not really want to come to Hungary, and he didn't take really seriously this question. He took seriously the humanitarian aspect, but politically he very soon understood that he can only demonstrate his impotence if he is more involved. What happened later was that still the political solution remained on the agenda. The United Nations had several resolutions condemning the Soviet invasion, recalling the Hungarian government to start negotiation. All what was very important for a political solution, it was key, it was on the agenda for quite a long time, but at the same time it became more and more evident that no observers, no United Nations machinery can arrive to Hungary in any way to be involved in the political solution. So what later was Hammarskjöld's idea to establish a special committee on the problem of Hungary to investigate what really happened in Hungary. And that was a very important and a very serious body of five diplomats who started to work on what really was the reason of the revolution, how the revolution happened, what are true from the accusations the Soviet and the communist propaganda had, that it was nationalistic and fascist and anti-Semitic and so on, and then to find out a kind of what solutions could be worked out, if any. However, 4 of November was the time when the revolution was crashed, and the Special Committee on the Problem of Hungary was established in January 15, 1957. So it was a bit late, to put it nicely, and the idea of the Special Committee was to create a report, and this report would be discussed by the General Assembly, and new resolutions will be then taken. This was the very important, very interesting task the UN had to investigate what really happened in Hungary, because its international consequences are also very important. And this five-member committee, which had the mandate to find out what really happened in Hungary, started to collect documentation, which is extremely interesting, and these were the documents that I could find and consult in New York lately. And also, as they were not allowed to Hungary, the Kádárian Hungary did not accept that the UN has anything to do with the Hungarian Revolution. So actually, the original cable of Imre Nagy of October 58, saying that it's an internal affair and the UN has nothing to do with that, remained the position of the Kádár government after 4th of November, which is more than paradoxical. The same paradoxical is that János Szabó had his mandate from Imre Nagy, cabled to New York, and I could find all this. They said, Dag Hammarskjöld said, it's very unusual way to send an accreditation by cables, but we shall accept it because the situation is so controversial. So anyhow, what happened later was that as the Special Committee was not allowed to enter Hungary, then they had a chance to meet many of these revolutionaries who left the country, 200,000, so they found 111 witnesses from different parts of the society who had different roles during the revolution. The foreign minister, in quotation marks, because Imre Nagy remained the foreign minister, but György Heltai was the one who really had the foreign affairs to deal with. He was also giving testimony, and other people there were the doctor from the Corvin circle, where the fightings were probably the heaviest. There was revolutionaries, there were students, peasants, there were communists, there were AVH people. And then this huge amount of testimonies became the basis of the report that was written later. And there was a very interesting process of selecting these witnesses, and actually a key figure in this process was this Danish diplomat, Poul Bang Jensen. The other very important part was that they wanted to remain anonymous. There were three witnesses who publicly gave their testimonies. Anna Kétli, a minister of the Imre Nagy government, a social democratic politician, a wonderful woman. Béla Király, who was the head of the National Guard, a military figure, also a charismatic personality. And József Kővágó, who was the mayor of Budapest, and he was a smallholders party member, so he had a very special and very important insight of the political machinery that was happening. So these were the three people who gave open testimonies when the press was there, and the rest, for all the other 108 persons, were behind closed doors because they knew very well, the United Nations knew very well that it had a certain risk for those who were giving testimonies. Not only for themselves, political murders were quite common in that time of the Cold War, but also for their relatives in Hungary and for their fellow freedom fighters. Because they give testimonies and they say, I was at the Corvin Circle, I was fighting with him and him and him, and then we planned this and so on. So for the Kádárián secret police, who was working at the very same time on the revenge of the revolution and were making court cases of each of the revolutionaries who was involved in any way in the events, for them it was a wonderful raw material to recycle it and then to use it for the legal repression of the after the revolution. So Bang Jensen was the one who was very careful that it should be kept confidentially. The United Nations was not careful at all. So there were several conflicts between Bang Jensen and his bosses that he knew the risk what those revolutionaries take, and also it was very important because the revolutionary was directly communicating with him. And they said, I do not trust the UN. The UN didn't care with us, but I trust you. So he was not only the one who realized the importance of his role, but he also had a list of names. He could identify each witness who gave a testimony under a code name. And he had this list in his pocket, and that was also another very important conflict that later developed tragically. It was a very important report, and when that was written and that was produced, a very interesting timing happened. And this is again that we can reconstruct from the background in the archives. That originally they wanted to introduce this report to the General Assembly session, which started its work in September 56. So until February, March, maximum April, the report should have been done. It wasn't done. Again, why wasn't it? And then they started to have the final drafts in May, and very strangely, when the report was published, it was just June 20th, when everybody went for vacation. And then, when there was a suggestion that let's have an emergency session, Hungary is in a very bad shape, everybody knew that the legal revenge or reprisal started, so people were arrested, imprisoned, interned, lost their jobs, so this whole revenge started. So maybe they can stop it somehow with the United Nations, has the Hungarian issue on its agenda, and maybe with a harsher way would respond to the Hungarian government's kind of lack of cooperation. There was no consequence whatsoever in the UN, only that the mandate of Hungary was suspended. But when the emergency session idea arrived to New York, the Secretariat of the UN blocked the process. And it very carefully worded cables were sent to the President of the General Assembly of that time, Prince Van Vaitayakan, a Thailandese diplomat, that the major part as Andrew Cordier, the deputy or undersecretary general of Hamaskjöld, said, the major part of the member states would not vote for an emergency session. So let's have the report discussed in September. So nearly a year was given to Kádár and to the Soviets to consolidate their power in Hungary without a concrete involvement of the UN, except the humanitarian assistance to save Hungarians from dying in hunger or from have different kind of epidemics. Even when the Hungarian issue was on the agenda in September 1957, hope started to renew. Even there were rumors, there was a very interesting kind of secret reports about the atmosphere of the population and about the how people think about that, and we can find it at the State Security Archive, that many people think before the General Assembly session, nearly a year after the revolution, that the Soviets will have to go once the report will be introduced to the General Assembly, and the General Assembly will have a voting or will vote about what really happened in Hungary, and then the Soviets and Kádár has to observe what the United Nations resolution demands. It was not the case, of course. There was a debate in 57, there were new resolutions given, and unfortunately nothing moved further, and also Kádár and at that time the leaders of the country could feel that they can do whatever they want. The UN would not even deny their access to the very UN machinery. There was Peter Mode, the ambassador of Hungary to the United Nations, who could speak at the General Assembly, who could use all the equipment and all the machinery of the UN, even if Hungary's mandate was suspended, but we could find also in the archives, for example, Hungary's fee for the UN's membership was taken from the Kádár's government. So the legal situation seemed that there is a continuation of the Hungarian membership. Actually, only there are certain periods when they cannot exercise all their rights. Let's try to slow down the process of the reprisal, not to take that horrible revenge. The UN could have helped probably in that, or at least that was the illusion of the Hungarians. So they were smuggling out information to the United Nations, to New York, with huge risks. That time, even if Hungary was a member of the United Nations, to provide any information to the West or to the United Nations meant high treason. And if people were caught, and they were caught, they were sentenced, and four of them were executed for spying for the UN or for submitting information to the West. And what happened with this information in the UN? They were received and they were just filed away. And when they were filed away, it was very easily accessible for all the secret services who were working there very diligently. So I also met with a Hungarian revolutionary, a journalist, who in 57 went to the French embassy, gave a testimony what's happening in Hungary, not during the revolution, it's history. Now, in the summer of 57, and it was by French diplomatic channels, were immediately sent to New York, arrived to the Secretariat of the UN, and the very same person could see his testimony at a police chamber in Budapest, and he was sentenced to 10 years in prison. That's why Bangyaz is so careful about not to let any information, any documentation out of his hands. The United Nations, for a very long time, as I mentioned, didn't give any access to these documents, what we wanted to study. And I started this work more than 25 years ago, so I wanted to have, and I was applying again and again, I was rejected. However, I could find two personal archives with United Nations very delicate documents that I could consult, and which was actually smuggled out from the UN. One was by a wonderful woman, Claire de Hedervary, a Hungarian-born Belgian citizen who was assistant and translator at the United Nations Special Committee on Problem of Hungary, and she realized how important this task that he has, so she decided if she can take away one or two documents, then she would do that, because it will be a wonderful historical source in the years to come. At the end of the work, she could save 8,366 items. Items mean that one of these are 40 or 60 pages long. So you can imagine if a junior employee at the UN could just take away more than 8,000 items, how is it a professional agent to work in this environment? Poul Bang-Jensen was the one who not only who didn't have only conflicts because of the secrecy or the security conditions, but he was also in a certain moment, just at the end of 57, ordered to turn over the list of witnesses to his bosses. And then he realized that it may not be a very good idea. And it was only at the a year after when the investigation already started. Why would they need it now? So he rejected, he said that he gave his word, so he will not give these names to anyone. And then a long process started, and it's very interesting that this long process took a lot of energy and a lot of legal and administrative development, how to humiliate Bang-Jensen, how to demonstrate that he cannot win, how to frighten him. And then he didn't give up, and then he was fired from the United Nations. Actually, the day when he was fired from the United Nations, the date of the letter of sending him away, signed by Hammarskjöld, was 16th of June 1958, which was the day when Imre Nagy and his fellow martyrs were executed. The United Nations also realized that they had all the information about the secret trials. They had all the information about Imre Nagy, when he was taken from this prison to the other one, how the party propaganda started to speed up his efforts to criticize, and how workers started to demand, in quotation marks of course, that the leaders of the revolution would be properly punished. But it took the UN by a total surprise, and when the news of the executions arrived to New York, there was no special committee. They couldn't find a special representative of Hungary to respond to that, but something had to be said about that. So it was again a very typical and very critical moment how to respond by the UN to that act of murder, political murder. After the summer of 57, and again this can be revealed by the new archival evidence, the special committee, which still had the mandate to work. Originally, the United Nations gave the role of the special committee to report on the revolution and then to have supplemental reports about the events, how it will develop in Hungary. And when a second report and a third report was created and the special committee secretariat wanted to issue all this report, the secretariat of the United Nations said that it was enough. Don't have anything more. And that was again a very painful process to see that informations are arriving, the agenda should be filled with what's happening in Hungary, and yet there is a kind of sabotage, to use again Bang-Jensen's word, to block the process to work out some solution regarding Hungary. And then a supplemental report had to be issued after the execution of Imre Nagy and Palmolive and the others. So in a haste, they started to recall the special committee, which didn't exist anymore, so they had to find the people who substituted their bosses. And again, they published a report in the summer of 58, mainly about apologizing why the UN didn't do anything more significant what it did, and how the Soviets and the Hungarians and the Romanians and the Yugoslavs and all who were involved in the kidnapping of Imre Nagy and the imprisoning and then executing did not respond favorably to any kind of request of the United Nations. That was a major scandal, but already that was far from the time when Hungary was a headline in the international press. So unfortunately, that remained an example that the United Nations was not able and was not willing to help in a case that seemed to be lost. The organization itself wanted to be untouched by any kind of outside criticism or even inside criticism. And also it was particularly a very difficult time. Cold War was going on and people, of course, were afraid that different types of conflicts could accelerate. And in Hungary, there is no real way to help. And then when Bang-Jensen was fired from the United Nations, he decided that he will not give up his fight. He will prove that he was right. He was a stubborn Danish fundamentalist Democrat. He said that I will go all the way and prove to this other Scandinavian, actually Hammarskjöld, that he is not right. And somehow, if this precedent in Hungary can happen, then the whole idea of the UN, the whole mandate, will be just evaporated. If a stronger country can do whatever it wants and the UN will assist in that, why did we organize? Why did we unite all these nations? So he was a kind of idealist and also a charismatic figure with an immense sympathy from the Hungarian revolutionaries and also from the international press. And when he was not giving up his fight, he was offered to have final proofs that the Soviets have a control on certain members of the secretariat, very high-ranking members of the secretariat. And we did not know that it was a trap, or he was offered to some kind of evidence, or that was just the end of his strengths. But what happened that Paul Bangezen disappeared for 3 days, just at Thanksgiving in 59. He had 5 children and he was a fantastic father. So, and then he was found dead in Alley Pond Park in Long Island with a farewell letter in his pocket written to his wife, which had very interesting, hidden, probably coded messages saying, for example, that I underestimated the forces I was up against. Meanwhile, he said to his wife that I will never underestimate the forces I am up against. So that may have said that these are the same forces I was referring to. And in the right down corner, there was a little 6A, which may have referred to a building when the hearings were organized in Vienna, Wallnerstrasse 6A, and still we do not know what happened there. Probably when the Soviet archives will be open, you will probably see that I may not. Then you may have a final idea what this little note could have meant. Anyhow, he was found dead, and I don't want to go very much details, my time is going to be over soon, but he was cremated in 2 days just to clean the scenery. And so no further investigation was done. Actually, there were 2 autopsy reports, and the 2 reports contradicted to each other, which is also very interesting. So there are a lot of very, very murky, very difficult, very shabby things that we do not see yet clearly. And the interesting part is that the FBI, Federal Bureau of Investigation, started immediately an investigation of what happened there, political murder probably. And then the Washington office of the FBI stopped the investigation. Don't go after that, guys. I'm not only applied for the United Nations for the secret files, but I am, by the Freedom of Information Act, I'm also applying for FBI files. And for a long time I was constantly rejected that, don't ask, we don't have anything. And then 2 years ago, I received an answer that actually we have something like 1,300 pages about Bangezen. Oops. So still I am on the process of waiting for the 1,300 pages, probably very exciting material that may give or may not give an answer what happened with Paul Bangezen before he died or when he died or after he died. It again shows that it was not only the Soviets, it was not only the United Nations, it was probably an international game, and Hungary in a sense was a loser of this game. So it was also very interesting to see how the General Assembly was voting to keep the Hungarian issue on the agenda. It started to melt. At the beginning, there was a major part of the member states that let keep the Hungarian issue on the agenda. And by 61-62, this majority started to shrink. And that was very critical. I saw also the correspondence of the American State Department and the other Western democracies that it's extremely embarrassing if we shall not have enough vote to keep the Hungarian issue on the agenda. So after a while, a compromise was born that if Kádár would give amnesty to the political prisoners, then Hungary will get back its seat in the United Nations and its mandate will not be suspended and it will be somehow rehabilitated. That's again a very interesting process.
Thank you very much. It was very, very interesting.